Hello everybody, and welcome to Chaotic Neutral Games. My screen just went a bit weird, which is why I was stuttering right at the beginning. But as long as you guys can see me, that is fine. So, we are going to continue with Star Wars Legends of the Sprawl, here with Corinne, Felicia, Paul, and Ed. Now, previously they were doing withdrawal symptoms, where they went off to recover a genetic treatment for a contact of Boss Nala, the smuggler boss of the Warren that they live in. We are now past that. They've finished the mission, and they ended up getting a large sum of money from last time, which they're now the proud owners of, what was it, something like 1.7 million, something like that. And they are currently returning back from that mission, and we're going to roleplay going through that mission and then coming through out the other side into the next mission, which is called the Shame Den. So, with no further ado, whilst I sort out my Discord and whatever the hell happens there, let's go a long time ago in a galaxy far, far away. And welcome back, everybody, and welcome to our players.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello, hello. Ah,
so we've made a couple of changes regarding the setup for Legends of the Sprawl now. And first of all, for the players, there's no obligation on your astromech anymore. I've put him into full NPC mode, which also means he doesn't roll a...
Destiny dice.
He doesn't roll a destiny dice anymore. So I'm going to reset the destiny completely. You're starting a new mission anyway. And there's a few things that you're going to have to wrap up before we go into the into Nala's Warren and all the rest of it. For one thing, you have a Jawa on board. First of all, let's get it so that we reset the destiny pool. So can I ask you all to roll destiny for me, please?
Special roll destiny.
Yay!
That looks pretty average, actually. I was gonna say good, then it was average.
Yeah, I think this one we need to remove, one of the destiny points, because Chevron rolled two, and I think you only can get
yep.
one. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm going to get rid of it now. Where is it?
Mine. There you go.
There we are.
Do you roll one, Simon, as well, though?
Nope. I don't roll any. It's all. It's because basically all of yours, when they turn black, belong to me anyway, so I don't roll one. Previously, I used to roll one for X4 because X4 was a player character when there were three of you. Now there's four of you. He's a non-player character. Okay. So let's get started. The Lakota is hurtling through hyperspace. You're all a little giddy with the events of the last few days. I've reset your strain because about 3 days have passed, And mostly you've just been trying to get the hell out of Dodge, knowing that you've annoyed a bunch of spice traders on the way in. You've decided just to get as many systems between you and them as possible. The Jawa that you picked up towards the end, who, as far as you're aware, was helping you by slicing and making sure that nobody could track where you were, is in the spare cabin of the Lakota, and is, for the most part, just staying there. And you can see is coding some sort of program. They haven't asked for access to your ship's network, and just seem to be working with their own system. So I'm going to start this with the end of day three. So Nima, you check that everything is okay, and leaving the droids to do droidy things, you head back to your quarters and get all cleaned up and go to bed.
Mm-hmm. Cuddling with Victoria, very important.
Ah, yes, of course. I keep forgetting that you're married to Victoria. Victoria, you can tell that Nima is having a bit of a nightmare. Not so much that you want to wake her up, but she's just this. You know, it's like a dog running in their sleep. She's just kind of every now and again reaching out for something, and at one point she almost looks like she's picked something up and is looking. But let's take a look at it through Nima's eyes. You open your eyes, and in front of you is a pair of hairy hands, and they're holding a set of files and walking down a corridor that you recognize very well. This is clearly Matar's vault, the vault that you've recently been in. And it takes a couple of reflective surfaces and looking at the hands and things like that, although you can't move your eyes around, you're literally looking through somebody else's eyes. Mm-hmm. That the person that you're looking through is the small drawer that came into the scene when you were negotiating with Matar. So if I just go into our mugshots and remind you that a space hamster and looks like this.
I'm just gonna get rid of, because currently everybody's looking at Victoria.
Yeah. If you can bring up my my screen so I can show you. It's the small drawl accountant that walked in on you. You watch as she is walking down the corridor, and there's two things that occur to you straight away. The first is that she's a force sensitive, and you're somehow through the force seeing through her eyes as you sleep. You also know instinctively that her name is Musfa, M-U-S-F-A. She ducks into a maintenance hatch, and you can tell that she's doing this, that she's going somewhere where she's not supposed to go. You can feel the trepidation as she ducks into the maintenance hatch and starts to walk amongst the conveyors and sorting arms that make up Matar's vault retrieval system. In amongst this vault retrieval system, there's a small crate that's clearly not being moved along the system, and it's tucked in away in a corner. She walks up to it, runs her hands over it, and presses the seal to unlock it, and says, "Why does the Force lead me here?" You can tell that she's speaking in drawl, but you understand the language immediately because she does. She opens the crate, and inside is a thermal detonator, a blaster pistol, and a holonap. She ignores the weapons and goes straight for the holonap. It fires into life and shows a map of the galaxy. She manipulates the holonap, and suddenly it highlights a planet out in wild space right at the edge of the Empire. Past the edge of the Empire, called GR5-47. So GR547.
Right.
The drawl says, "This isn't for me, but I feel like I have done what the forces compelled me to." She picks up the thermal detonator, sets the timer, throws it in the crate with the map, and walks off. You can feel that as the drawl's walking away from this task that the force has compelled her to do, you, with every step that she steps away from the crate, your lock on her gets less and less and less, and you start to slip into darkness once more. Then, in a series of flashes, like strobe flashes, you get images of a stone cellar, a large animal carcass that's long since died, and in front of it, a stone bowl. Quite a wide bowl, about the size of a plate, shallow in the middle, completely unadorned, just made out of a strange red igneous rock. And as far as you can see from the flashes, the bowl is glowing with force energy. With the end of the flashes, you snap awake. What would you like to do?
Okay. I will, like, bring up my notebook and just write down everything I saw. So I saw a map, a location of a planet. Did I see the planet's name?
Yeah, I've already given it. The designation of the planet is GR5-47.
Yeah, I write that down. GR5. And then I also, like, note down the bowl. What did it look like? Was it just a random bowl, but that had like force energy on it?
It was a wide bowl, about 2 foot wide. Mm-hmm. So fairly big. We're talking quite a wide bowl. Quite substantially made igneous rock, a kind of red, dark red igneous rock, and it looks like it's been put down for like food or something. It's got some kind of rotted crap at the bottom of it. And as far as you could see, it was glowing with force energy.
Right. Okay. Force ball. Because that's the thing.
Bowl of force energy.
Yeah, bowl of force energy. And I will... If Victoria's not already awake, I will wake her up and tell her all about it.
What? Are we attacked?
No.
And she will start reaching to the side of the bed, like where the sword is.
No. I just had this vision. Not really a dream. I had a vision of... Do you remember the drawl we saw at the station?
Yes.
She's a force sensitive. And...
Okay.
Yeah. And I got a vision through her, and she... Like, the force was compelling her to go and look at a map, and then there was this planet that was on the map, and this planet, and I show her in my notes what it's called. It's numbers.
That's a bit outside of the reach we've been in before, but we might be able to take a look at it.
X4,
he's better at that.
Yeah, the I don't know the exact coordinates of it, but I assume he would know where the... Because it's not a well-known planet, Simon's told me as much.
Well, at least you got a clue. We could ask Enola. She knows more than anyone.
Yeah, and anyway, we should go back to sleep. But also, there's like this artifact, I think, there, which is covered in force energy. So if we could, I would want to check it out.
What type of artifact? Is it a sword?
Not a sword. It's a bowl.
Love that was Victoria's first thing. Oh, is it a force sword?
It's a bowl.
A bowl. And you had a vision. Boy, this reminds me of those trippy things old grandma Gertrude used to tell us.
Yes, Gertrude.
Yeah.
Yeah.
sleep is better.
We call it the sleep, and then I will go and tell the droids and Chevron.
The droids.
The droids.
And the Chevron. Droids. Come on, you know.
At least you've got names. Yeah, you've got, just you've got filed got under, name drop I'll there. Go tell the equipment.
No! I said...
I think... I prefer my band to be called Chevron and the Droids. Thank you very much.
No, the droids and...
Oh, that's what Chevron had a problem with, is that he was at the end, he wasn't the lead singer. I see.
The technical term should be the crew.
Yeah.
There is one word, encompasses everyone.
Yes, I shall tell the rest of the crew. There we go.
Sure.
It might be a good place to lay low for a little.
Yeah. Well, that will be when we are away. Kurt, you guys are not in my bedroom.
No.
So I'm just going to say, yep, you have the rest of your night's sleep. You get up and you can see that X4 is charging in his dock, and Chevron is, what's Chevron doing?
We're just eating space cereal at this point. If it's early in the morning, black coffee and space cereal.
Yep, sure. And JT is, now that you're in hyperspace, you don't really need to do a huge amount. You're just following routes. But JT's just kind of, I should imagine, just chilling out near the pilot station just in case he needs
he's
to...
He's sat in his chair.
In his chair. Yeah, I like it. Okay. So his chair as opposed to the pilot's chair. That's fine. I love that your one possession... other than your kind of roleplay required guns and shit, is a chair.
Yes.
What possessions do droids need?
Yeah, true. Yeah.
He is a pilot. He needs his chair.
I'd say your chair probably has a charging dock that that X4 has fitted into it, thinking if it's going to be here, it's going to have a function.
It's the equivalent of my bedroom.
Yeah. You just... sit there, and you know, if you really need to power down, you can stare into space.
It's like real life. Okay. I move from my work chair to my play chair.
It's important. I should check. Well, I play and work in this one chair. I guess I could change the chair, even though I'll be sat in exactly the same position. That feels right.
I have my chair. I do everything in this chair except sleep. I'm glad for that.
Yeah,
it's got bad if you sleep in the same chair that you work and game in.
Chair, though.
It's dangerous. So, Nima, you wake up. What do you want to do?
I'm going to go and tell the rest of the crew.
Sure. I want you to RP this one because it may trigger something.
Yeah. Ooh. I will start by gather everybody around like the dying, because I'll make some proper breakfast. I'll boil some eggs, space eggs.
Mm-hmm.
Space eggs.
they can just be eggs. They don't need to be space eggs. They can just be eggs.
No.
Actual eggs do exist.
It's spam. It's like space ham.
Yeah.
Oh dear.
Thanks. Yes, Spigs. Yes, Jordan, Spigs.
Green specks and spam.
Specs.
So, Nima, we can buy a bowl if you need one. We're millionaires.
Yes.
The first question now, so the planet that was specified was this planet, which is a string of numbers and things and doesn't have a name, so therefore I can't...
GR5-47.
Yeah. See,
the planet is this, GR547.
Yeah, GR547. Yes. Do you know
off
it?
Off the grid. Not in
our Can we buy it?
We can't buy a planet, Chevron.
Don't know. We might be able to buy this planet.
Why?
Does it look like an expensive planet?
What did you say, JT?
It's a shithole.
Right.
It's an abandoned safari planet. It was taken off the roster before I, disappeared, went missing.
You,
whatever
you
they...
You did mention the skeleton of a large creature?
Is this the planet you got left on?
No. No. Did...
You were saying skeletons of creatures and...
No, I didn't see any skeletons.
Yes, you did.
Yeah, I did.
Yes, you did. Yes, you saw did. The carcass, of the long-rotted carcass of a large creature.
Yes. Yes, I saw a skeleton of a big creature, a bowl that had, like, a large, like, ceremonial bowl. It's not like...
a bowl.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Going back to the skeleton. Have you ever heard of a shame den?
Have I heard of it?
Nope, none of you have heard of a shame den. Well, actually, Chevron's heard of a shame den, but it's not the same thing.
I will volunteer, I will sort of look quizzically and say, you mean, you know, and make some sort of like salacious hand gestures and see what we're having.
Yes. Yes. A shame den.
Well, what is
really? Would you care to explain, Chevron?
Well, there are ladies present, JT. I'm not entirely sure.
Why would that stop you explaining what a shame den is?
Let me hear what you think a shame den is first, JT. Just illuminate me, please.
Can I make you do a charm roll?
Yes, absolutely. Charm versus discipline in this case, please.
That's a red and a purple for me.
Is that doubt and glory? No, it's
Kappa. It's not good.
Okay, Kappa to you too.
No, I'm curious what you're thinking first.
Well, usually you need at least 5 people and a small amount of agricultural equipment, and then usually there's about a grand's worth of credits of various illicit substances involved, and then you need about a...
It's not the same thing. Up until the illicit substances, it was the same thing, and then it wasn't the same thing.
Good to know. Please tell us more.
So what is a shame then? Not Chevron.
Sorry, I've already briefed Ed on what a shame then is. I've just realised when you said the farming equipment, you were like, oh yeah, actually it does involve. That's priceless. Sorry, carry on.
You know JT stands for jerk transport, right?
Yes, you've told us.
They used to take pretty boys onto planets and let them hunt things.
Yes.
Some of the pretty boys were terrible. And
as expected.
Less scrupulous companies than my ex-employers, owners, would capture animals and keep them in these shame dens. They'd withhold food, make them weak, and when a pretty boy arrived, release it and herd it towards the pretty boy so he could take his shot. And even if he missed, it's quite likely the thing would die anyway and he could take the credit.
Fun?
No honor at all.
They're not fun. And I have no love for my previous employers, but they wouldn't have ever done that. Even they wouldn't have done that.
So your previous employer employed shame dens, or they did not?
They did not.
They did not.
Well, that's at least something.
They're bastards in other ways.
Oh. Yeah,
very much so.
I assume so. Well, most of those companies are scumps anyways.
But I'm going to bring up a screen. I presume there's a screen somewhere in the mess hall.
There are screens everywhere.
Oh, there's screens everywhere.
Star Wars.
And I'm just going to put up the map to Geo547. Just kind of point out on the galaxy.
Yep.
There it is.
You know, Nima, that it, even if you had got X4 to look for it, X4 would not have got GR547 because it's not on the star chart.
Yes.
It is completely unmapped.
Oh.
And JT, who knows about this place, would you think?
The safari companies. People who pay the safari companies. That's about it, I reckon.
And the companies are probably the only people that know where it is, you think?
Well, I know where it is. It's there.
could we go? I would be very interested in going.
I'm just the pilot, you tell me where we're going.
I mean,
Ed, point of order, as the pilot, you need to resupply. You haven't got enough supplies to be confident that you'll get there and back.
Also, I want my new shiny armor.
Yes, that too.
I must admit, this sounds like an awfully convenient place to lay low if we need to, though.
Yeah.
For supplies. We're going to need supplies if we go to a deserted place. Because I am not living off rations again.
No need to live off rations. I can provide for you.
Yeah. Oh, I know, JT, but...
a planet.
A balanced diet involves more than just hunted meat. Unfortunately, as much as I prefer that...
There's two parts to hunter-gatherer.
Yeah, as you said. But yes, we should probably get some fuel as well.
There is that.
We'll keep on heading then, and then turn around quickly.
Yeah,
I think it's always
quick stop this time.
We definitely need to keep Nala sweet after we did manage to fulfill her contract, and I think it's best to give her the goods that we promised.
Well, I suggest we send ahead anything we want to supply. Send some comms ahead. We've got some friends on the station who might be able to collect some stuff for us.
Absolutely, yeah. You've got, at the moment on the station, you've got Tweak. By this point, Yantu has found his way back to the station after the bender he had with Chevron and Lias Gran.
Yantu, who we keep blowing up.
Found his way back. I like that idea. Just
Yantu is the one that we keep blowing off and telling, oh, next time you can join us. And then next time, like, next time you can join us.
Poor thing, he idolized you. That's
think I'm missing with Chevron for another party.
But yes, he idolized you to start with, but now you've kind of cooled off. So yeah, let's see who we got in Nala's Warren. You got Yantu, Tweak, Nala herself, Caldrilla, who will take orders. Marla, the Wookiee laborer that you saved in episode one. And so that's before Victoria joined in. Mm-hmm. And also Osna. Osna is the Rodian gun nut that helped you rebuild X4.
Oh yeah.
So I lost his name, so I had to rename him.
I thought he was a bit grumpy, and JT probably has his name, so.
I've already spoken to Ed, and it's Osna now.
Okay.
Yeah, it's lost in a notebook somewhere.
We lost it
and
write it down. Yeah. Well, you've got a party fund of 1,895,903 credits. You're pretty sure that, you know, you're going to be good. Put together your wish lists and send ahead. And basically, we will say that you have pre-ordered a bunch of things, but you'll do the rolls when you get there.
Yeah.
There's also the small issue of the Jawa that you have in your hold. not in your hold, in one of the guest rooms, actually, because you've got enough guest rooms, thanks to your guys being mostly dwarves. Droids.
But so, they're not dwarves.
And the fact that Victoria and Nima is using bedroom.
Yeah, as well. We're using the same...
If you look at number 3 on the ship map, down and to the right, there is a double bed, so I'm going to say that's probably yours.
Simon, the screen you have up at the moment, you do not have the ship map. You currently, I'm looking at
We're looking at your internet browser.
Yeah, we're looking at your at the Sky Jedi is what we're looking at.
Oh, okay. Let me sort that out. Very strange.
At some point while we're flying, Chevron is going to wander into Nima's room where all of the jewelry we still have is stashed, and I'm going to put on as much as I physically can. Yeah, I think we have like 80 grand. We have 80,000 creds of just diamonds and jewels.
Oh, yeah, because we got that.
And everything else. And I'm just going to strut around the ship.
80,000 creds.
Yeah.
And you're just going to strut around the ship in it.
Yep, going to feel good. Going to just feel my money.
Okay. Right.
So, Corinne, is it showing that now?
Yeah, it's showing that now, yeah. Yeah, good it's petty cash, right. That's correct, Jordan. Just petty cash. Fine.
He was a good slicer. Maybe we could recommend him a new job working on the Nala. She seems to like that sort of people who can do stuff like that.
Maybe we should ask the fellow where he wants to be dropped off. I mean, admittedly his choices are limited, but I'm sure he can get passage from the Warren to points thereafter if he needs. Maybe also we should ask him why he decided to make such... If he gave any more detail about the retreat that he rather rapidly beat from our previous...
Sure.
Sounds good.
Okay. So you summon the Jawa to the communal area, which is number 7 on the map, and the Jawa comes up and says, how can I help you?
Mr. Rat, I think it was, wasn't it?
Yeah. We're rats to most people, so why not?
Well, I mean, we'll call you by any title you should wish.
Yeah, we're happy to call you by, you know, a normal name, if you like.
Rat for now. And you can see, really kind of cold.
Yeah. I mean, it seems like you're on a fresh horizon, Mr. Rat. Why not choose a new nom de plume?
I'm not going to use my handle. That's just stupidity itself. I guess... you can call me... Rummage.
Rummage. Right.
Rummage.
A fantastic new handle. Mr. Rummage, then. It seems like you've become entangled in our business. I'd like to ask how you feel about that.
It's part of the job, isn't it? Being a slicer. I managed to keep them off your back for a certain amount of time, but after that they got hold of the council, you see. They still couldn't track down your exact whereabouts, but they knew where you were going, and once they'd managed to identify your ship, well, I was hot-footing it over to you to tell you to get to your ship, but it turns out you're already on the way there.
Well, to be honest, I didn't think you were legitimate at first. I thought you were just trying to get extortionate some money from us.
I was. But also I was going to deliver. Is that extortion?
No. What I mean by paying... I thought that if we didn't pay, that you were just going to alert everybody where we were.
Oh, it was. Yeah.
Oh, right.
Our friend Mr. Rummage is clearly a legitimate businessman and knows the price of his services. And in fact, that reminds me, and I will give him the, I think it was 300 creds extra I offered him as a bonus if we got off planet successfully.
Sure, yeah. He pockets it, and at this point I want you to do me a charm check, and I'm gonna downgrade the difficulty rather than upgrade it. Do it with diff 2.
Ooh, no. Oh, no, actually, it's good. But with many disadvantages.
It is good, yeah. He still doesn't 100% trust you. But there's a kind of very, not resigned nod, very kind of definite nod of, okay, we can do business. We're not friends, but we can do business. And he pockets the money and says, okay, you need anything on the ship? You got a slicer.
Well, we were wondering where you would like to go. If you would like to go, there's a asteroid where we have our base of operation where that could use another slicer. Or if there's
an asteroid.
Yes.
Oh. Okay. What is it, like a mining post or something?
Yes. Is that right, Simon? Well, it used to be. Well, it used to be.
Are you? Well, he's asking if it's one of these kind of mining rigs that's attached to the side of an asteroid.
I think Niles Warren's known what, as I understand, isn't it? It is known, a known place.
Yeah. It's not very well known. He'd have to make a check if you name it.
I think we just mentioned that our next stop is Niles Warren. And just say that basically that we're going there next, and he's more than happy to alight there and, you know, make his own form.
Okay, so yeah, he passes. He has heard of Nala's War, and he goes, "Oh, you're going out there to a smuggler's base." You notice he doesn't say the word sprawl. He obviously doesn't know the name of the region from the people who live there, but he knows that there's smuggler's asteroid bases on the fringe space. He goes, "No, that could work.
I was gonna say
drop me off anywhere where the Empire isn't about, but
well, that qualifies. Yeah.
Okay, I wish you were taking me to somewhere better, but I'll accept it.
And we'll even, for your sterling service, we're happy to waive any transport fees that will be incurred as part of your service. Consider this gratis."
He goes, at first it looks like he's about to argue with you, and goes, "No, I guess that's fair. Thank you." And, now, you know, he seems to have relaxed a little bit. He's less confrontational.
Yeah. I mean, if you wish, we can introduce you to one of our compatriots that's in a similar line of business to yourself on the locale. Perhaps you could collaborate? Who knows? But,
I don't know how much slices actually cooperate. They seem to be more like single, solo type of people.
Teams of slices are for team ups against. Yeah, that if you get like five good slices slicing into the Empire, they can make an absolute fortune. But then they're hunted for the next 10 years. But they do it because the haul is that good. There's short slicing, which is just doing small odds and sods, low renown, but low pay. And then there's the long slices or big slicing, or getting a big slice. And that is that you get together a team of expert slicers, you siphon off funds from the corporation or the Black Sun or something like that, and then you find the most remote place in the galaxy to go to until they get pissed off with someone else. Yeah, you hide, but you're rich. Yeah.
Oh, I wonder what Tweak did in the previous life, he says to the sky. But yes, we know some local talent.
Story.
We know some local talent, and I'm sure if you have the skills, I'm sure you can find some gainful employ alongside.
Yeah, all right. Sounds good. You know, pay's pay.
Absolutely. A fair day's pay for a fair day's work.
Oh, yeah. Like that. Yeah. Okay. And you can tell that there's a certain level of "we do not believe in a fair day's pay for a fair day's work" between Chevron and Rummage. Rummage quite clearly will try to get money for... through more questionable means, if not outright illegal, but very close to illegal.
Yeah.
And as is the nature of...
Racket he did is,
It is,
but also isn't. Think of the type of planet he was operating on. I'm pretty sure he was within the law, within quotation marks. There's not a lot of law there.
Yeah, that's fair. So yeah, Jawa's quite happy to stick around. And now that he knows that he's going to the edge of Imperial space, to a place where people don't ask questions, you can tell that he spends less time in his room, and actually does spend some time out in the communal area. You know, he plays some sabac with X4, and he's generally chilling out.
I'm getting X4 to do half-hourly scans of the system to make sure he's not in, because I still don't trust him.
Sure, he's a Java,
and you're a droid.
Yeah. Suddenly starts taking your part.
Yeah, you notice that Rummage, even though he's named himself Rummage, doesn't seem to be that kind of trash mechanic, outlaw tech type. He's an out-and-out slicer. He's very different to a lot of Jawas. He doesn't seem to be going much on the stereotype. Even his rig seems to be made out of premium parts. It doesn't look cobbled together.
Right.
Still don't trust him.
Chevron will salivate over any high-end tech and just be like, ooh.
It's all high-end tech, yeah. And it never leaves the Jawa's side.
I will be asking him where he got various bits of it and everything else.
He points out that everything was hard won, and he doesn't state who he got employed by, but he said, but for the most part, he was looking out for opportunities. He would sometimes contact them anonymously, sometimes have to risk an in-person face-to-face meeting, and help them with whatever machinations they were doing. You can tell, for the most part, he would look for dirty dealings on Eclectica, and then kind of walk up to them and say, I'm in. And then just get his cut that way. It's a case of, I'm not going to rat on you. Hence, rat. I'm not going to rat on you, but I expect to be brought in on the team, and I'll do my part. And it seemed to work quite well for him for a while.
Yeah.
Okay.
One other question I would like to ask Nemu before we get back. And I was like, so this bowl thingy. Now I leave all this religion stuff to you, Jeremy. But good force stuff or bad force stuff?
I felt mainly light side. I assume, Simon.
I just said it was raw force energy. It was surrounded by force energy. If you want, I will give you you can roll both force dice.
Mm-hmm.
And if you get the more light side points you get, the more you'll be able to detect. You can't use dark side points for this.
Obviously, yeah. 2 force dice and roll. 3 right sides.
Wow, 3 light sides. You know that this bowl was created by a Sith, but it doesn't have it isn't attuned to the dark side.
Okay. I didn't sense any dark side force with it. It was more just the normal force you feel around you every day. It seems to have been created by Sith, but it doesn't hold any dark side of the force in it.
It's raw force.
Raw, completely over Chevron's head.
So it's legit, right?
Minions bullshit. Yep. I think I know what you're on about, and I don't want to smoke whatever's in it.
No.
Smoke a Sith bowl. God.
Yeah, so it's, say good for stuff. Yes, good for stuff. No, bad for stuff.
Okay. So, you carry on, and you take a leisurely route back through the sprawl, not needing to do any checks. You only have to really do that when you're going in anger. And so, neat little cruise into the sprawl, and you can choose to dock in the Lakota to Nala's Warren, or you can go back to your base, If you go back to your base, you've got a Jawa on board that you may have to blindfold.
I am not going back to our base with the Jawa on board.
Sure. Okay.
I'm calling one of our friends to come out and pick up with just a skiff or something, so we don't even have to go close to Nala's Warren in our ship.
Yep, that's fine. And it is these days more chilled out and more mature Yantu, albeit when he looks at Chevron, you notice that there's a certain look of guilt on the young Trandoshan's face. There's very much just kind of a manly Chevron kind of thing. As he picks everybody up.
What did you see him do? Like
agricultural equipment.
Perfect. I don't know where we would have gotten it from, if I'm honest.
Gardening tool.
The answer to that.
Yantu pulls up and goes, you got an infestation, mate. And points to the Jawa, and the Jawa flips him the bird.
Fair.
I know, we're getting rid of him.
He just don't like him.
You notice that Yantu's never been on Lakota before, so he kind of takes a look around. Lakota's polished compared to the fact that you had a YT-1300 white van of space last time. Lakota is top of the range experimental ship, so for her size anyway. And he looks around kind of with a nod of approval, as if to say, "Yeah, going up in the world, like it." He tries to take the Jawa by the scruff of the neck, and the Jawa just says, "I know where to go," and Rummage goes onto the skiff. X4 says, "Do you want me to take the Lakota back?"
Because we can go on the skiff, and then X4 can take the Lakota to our base. Let's do that.
Okay. You get onto the skiff. Both Clarity and X4 stay on the ship, because between the two of them, they can do most of the functions. And you watch as the Lakota banks around and goes off to your base. So that they are now on the asteroid.
Do we have massive crate of gems?
Yes, you do. You have your cash, your fat cash. I should imagine you put it in a nondescript container and strapped it to Victoria.
Not like seven necklaces on Chevron. Will we take them off?
But between like Mr. T.
Please.
Ring on every multiple rings on every finger. It's amazing. The other thing is, we also have like a backpack full of jelly, basically, which is the cash, right?
Oh, yeah.
Yep, that's right.
Yep.
Yep.
That is
a million in
currency.
In the jelly.
Let's see.
How do you even pay in this?
Flan. Calamari flan.
Flan, that's it. I knew it had a really cool. Calamari flan. So it's a disc-shaped white and blue, slightly squishy object. Do I have a picture? I do. There we go.
Just make sure you bring it to the right
screen. I'm pretty sure this is from the Mandalorian, but there we go. So squishy blue currency, and that's Mon Calamari flan. You've got most of your million plus is in Mon Calamari flan, which is a nice exchangeable currency to be able to use. So the you get onto Nala's Warren, and because you had sent out for a skiff, standing there in the loading bay, or the docking bay, is Nala herself. The old Bothan gives a huge smile, and you can detect a little bit of relief as the Bothan's receiving you there. And I've got a male Bothan up on the screen, but that's the race. And she says,
"Ah, I see my specialists have done the job again. Tell me, was it bad? I kind of sent you into a somewhat of a stronghold there. Is Matar dead?"
No.
I'm pushing a trolley with the box with the medication on, and I'm just gonna straight up wheel it around in front of it and just put it no problem.
He's not dead. He agreed to...
We made a new friend.
Apparently.
Ah, excellent. Matar is quite powerful, if quite restricted with his power. Could be useful. Well, that's good. I mean, being able to go there and back and not end up with any heat on you. Fantastic.
Fantastic. Yeah, he asked us to go in...
Boss.
He asked us to go to the gambling planet.
We were on
the gambling planet.
Asked us to go to the gambling place on the gambling planet.
Yeah, you went to one of the many gambling cities. This was Eclectica, basically a floating Las Vegas on this ocean planet.
Just remind me, what's Nala's opinion on spice?
Nala's opinion on spice is that you can bring it onto the asteroid to get rid of it. She finds you selling it. I think the first thing she takes is your thumbs.
Okay, if it's selling it on the on the thing. Well, yeah.
You can't sell it or distribute it on her asteroid. If you do, thumbs. If you declare it and say, "Look, I've got some. I'm going to take it off the asteroid, but I'm not going to try to distribute it here," then you're fine. But she finds you selling it to anyone. Thumbs.
So I think, I would intend to recount our windfall early on in our adventures, and say that we've liquidated that asset. However, and then mention
which was a bad idea.
Well, you know, and say that didn't necessarily find us some favours, but at the same time, we, you know, didn't shit where we eat, so there you go. And then we then managed to place several clever wagers that allowed us to make a large withdrawal from the house on Eclectica, and that we're now sitting fairly pretty, although we're not sure we necessarily made any friends in doing so.
Indeed. Well, first of all, spice traders are renownedly territorial. Getting a territory as big as Eclectica and as rich as Eclectica, they would be powerful spice merchants. You better watch yourself. And as for clearing out the house, well, you didn't clear them out if you only took a million off them, but I'm sure they would have been very mildly irked for the embarrassment, you understand. You're hardly the type of clientele that's going to go back and lose it all again.
No.
As much as I would love to return to Eclectica, it seems like my kind of place, but yes, I think we'll be avoiding for a little while.
Yeah, and
there are some better places to go.
Though I don't understand why, because the spice we liquidated with the house and the thing rather than selling it on the street, so...
Who do you think runs the casinos?
Oh yeah, the spice traders, of course.
Yeah.
If anything, we gave them more to distribute later.
Yeah.
You did, but you made profit doing it, and they really didn't like that. It's more a case of controlling supply, you understand. They wanted to make sure that you were suitably spooked so that you didn't start thinking that this was a good spice run. You did gain a large amount of money with no heat whatsoever, remember? That's their asset. That's for them to enjoy. and the fact that you muscled in and took advantage of that that boon of Eclectica meant that you were taking something that belonged to them. As I say, they're very touchy and very territorial.
Speaking of heat, Nala, I trust no one's been sniffing around in our absence.
She points to, because the dock that you did was the main dock, which is Tunnel A, which is the large tunnel, big bore laser tunnel that would have come from a Super Star Destroyer. And, just a Star Destroyer. And she points over to Glory Row, which is one of the many terraced, mezzanines that go up the side of this otherwise round tunnel. And she's kind of made it into like a terraced step with kind of streets along the side, and each street overlooking the one below it. And do notice that Glory Row is an example of what happens if you cross Nala. She's a fair leader, but she's also a very very simple and blunt leader as well. And she says, third head along was the last one to come asking for you.
Right.
Compner agent, if I'm not mistaken. Ex-Compner agent. Ex-Compner agent before I exed him even further.
Oh, okay.
You do see that there's a scar on her upper arm, because she just wears a kind of leather vest for the most part. And there's a scar on her upper arm that she didn't have before. And she says, anyway, to the victor the spoils, and it looks like you're about to give a cash injection to my economy here.
Yes.
If the messages that I intercepted were correct.
Very much so.
Also, I believe for you, Victoria, there is a package that is currently being left with Cato. You know that Cato runs the exchange in Nala's Warren, and he's a Nemoidian. If you don't remember what a Nemoidian is, they were the bad guys in episode one, but not all of them are that bad. And even though the most of the Nemoidians are with the Trade Federation, there are a lot of Nemoidians out there trying to prove themselves. And so Cato is one such Nemoidian. Quite a nice person, a very honest merchant. Kind of tries a little bit too hard to prove how honest he is, because he has to shrug off the taint of the Trade Federation. And she says, "I believe that to unlock the package, you need to both pay for it and send data."
Yes. Expert has the data. Shouldn't be an issue.
Fantastic. Well, you may as well go as soon as you can. Cato will be closing up in a few hours.
Right.
So, you're on Nala's Warren. You have, 1,800,000. It's time to do a quick shopping spree. So
1,895,903.
Yep.
I gave away 300 of that. Remember?
I will adjust the document.
Updated.
Then.
Updated. Ed's already updated it, Simon.
Okay. Cool. Thank you. I can see. I love using Google Docs for stuff like this, because I can see where everybody's cursor is. With a huge amount of credits and equivalent thereof, the Tunnel A market, the large market that makes up most of Nala's Warren, being that this is a smuggler's hide, is yours for the taking. So first person I'm going to go to, because I know he's already prepared, is Ed. And so what's JT going to ask for?
Everything. JT is going to find Osna, because the message he sent was pretty much directly to Osna, with a few schematics.
Sure.
A conversation is going on, JT is just kind of zoned out, going through catalogs and drawing up schematics in his head.
yeah.
Yeah, I love the fact that, you know, you're there just looking at your internal internet browser. Basically, you're flicking through back issues of Guns and Ammo, effectively.
Pretty much.
Okay, so you're going to go off to Osna. The second that you turn up, Osna seems to have a... Osna, first of all, is a Rodian. I just realized that you guys remember the Gunnut, but the... This was so Osna is a Rodian, and he is one hell of a gun nut, absolutely obsessed. And so he, when you get there, he's already read the schematics, and he has out in front of him a series of equipment that seems to be ready for his commission.
Hey, I've got a full bag.
JT, how can I help you? Actually, I already know. So, let's go over these schematics. You want an upgrade, yeah?
Yeah.
I will go with JT to help him with any negotiation checks.
Okay, fair enough. He goes, so at the moment, what I can see is that you've got the upgraded metal paneling on your body. So that's a chassis upgrade. That's going to be fairly easy. We'll just take the current paneling off your frame. No need to mess with anything inside, and we can put that on top. Now, the wrists are going to be different. I'm going to have to take apart your arms to do that. But we can do it. I'm pretty sure I know what I want. So, I know what you want. So, what do you want done with the arms? Ed, push to talk.
Sorry, yeah, no, I've just completely blanked because there was something I may have actually forgotten to send to you because I got distracted this afternoon.
Okay.
Fair enough.
So I'm just going to point out on the schematic what you're putting in the arms. I want them here. And I'm going to point to the right leg and here. And I'm going to point on the back. So you don't need to take the arms apart at all.
Sure. Yeah, I can do that.
So, if you can describe for the viewers what you want done to JT's chassis.
Well, first things first, I'm putting down a duffel bag with three or four guns in it and just kind of spreading them out on the table.
Mm-hmm.
JT is getting, well, improved armor and also a couple of integrated holsters where he will have a couple of easy to access guns because last time he was on his own he got in a bit of a scuffle and only had a holdout blaster to defend himself with.
Yeah.
So yeah. What he's doing is he's getting holsters where he can hold some of the blaster carbines which we had in storage.
Yes.
One of which he is significantly altering, or hoping that Osner can significantly alter for him, to be a short-range monster.
Nice.
Okay.
Can I help with negotiation for the cost of this thing, Simon?
Yep, we'll go through the tech stuff first, but there will be a roll later. So, from what you can say...
costs when we're basically space rich?
Well, we can still do it, because...
Oh, yeah. Being rich and staying rich are two completely different things. So you basically want the traditional RoboCop integrated holster.
Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that's
okay,
where
so
the shotgun will be.
Okay, so a shotgun in one of your legs, and then if you reach behind your back, you get just what is going to be a more powerful carbine. Yeah.
Yes.
Cool. Okay. So, we've talked about this before. So you pull out the flamethrower attachment to your light repeating blaster and set it down on the table. Did you want to explain?
I never quite got this working right. It didn't seem to switch on. I think there's a connection that's missing somewhere. I think the harness is interfering. Mechanically, there are too many hard points. Of equipment for the hard points on the gun. So I just need to take the flamethrower off. So I'm going to say,
yeah.
use some of the parts from that if you need to.
Hmm. Well, the injection, ignition system on this is a flash emitter. I could take that apart, retrofit it, put it on the end of that carbine, and it would be able to produce an energy flash that would be, well, effective in an arc, but it would only be effective at short range. Is that okay?
Perfect.
And what he describes to you is a blaster sawn-off shotgun, which is what you were going for.
Nice.
So for anybody who, yeah. So for anybody who is follows Edge of the Empire, this is taking a blaster carbine, putting a forearm grip, a set trigger, and a spread barrel onto it, turning it into somewhat of a monster. Mm-hmm. If he pulls it out and fires, it only works over short range, but it is an indoor monster weapon, and that is now in. That's going to be put into your leg. And then you, on your back, you'll pull out again a small carbine, but that's just going to be given an augmented spin barrel. And you know, this goes. This explanation, I'm cutting it short. But Osner talks about this for a good hour as to what his recommendations are, and kind of you know, starts adjusting your schematics in front of you with your approval. You also wanted to have a cargo pack. Integrated into your back, and that will be the equivalent of a permanent backpack. Okay. So he puts it all together. He goes, okay, I've got everything ready. And you can see behind him, he's got this manufacturing equipment to stamp out all of the panels and things like that. He goes, you're going to be legless for about 3 hours, but after that, you're going to be a new man.
You did right kind of gives four.
I did, and I hear he's used his toy as well. So he starts totaling everything up, and he goes, by the looks of it, we're looking at, let's see, that's 24,000, 25,000, let's say 25,400.
JT just goes to pay the man.
Nima, this is where you jump in.
Yes. I will. Maybe we can come to. JT is buying quite a lot of stuff. Is there any way we can come to agreement to maybe a bit of a bulk buy discount?
Bulk buy? He's paying for top level artisanry here.
Yes, but lots of it.
He kind of looks over it all and. Looks at you, and you know he's not thinking that he's going to lose the sale, but a light kind of goes on in his head where he's there thinking, maybe if I do a good job here and give them a decent price, he'll come back next time, because I kind of want to be able to pimp this guy out as much as I can. And so he goes,
I'm listening.
Right.
Give me an offer. You don't give numbers. What you do is you're going to have to roll. Yeah, you roll against him.
Yeah.
So roll a negotiation check against a red and two purples.
Yep.
He always was a salty character. So it's quite. He's. You're going up against a prime artisan, and so he's kind of rival level.
And last time, I did insult him a few times.
Oh, well remembered. Add two black.
Yeah. Oh, no. Why did you say that? Well, JT is
it's
helping me.
It's true to the story. True to the story.
That it is.
It is. Well done.
I assume JT is helping me.
No, you're helping JT effectively, so JT is not helping you because he said specifically that he was just about to hand over the full amount. So he's actually mentioned that he didn't help you.
Well, I add a blue to. No, the charm card. That's not negotiation. So that's not go. But yes, I still add my force die to this. Okay.
Yep. Like I say, you don't need any extra help.
Okay. Ooh. I will re-roll that. That is just bad. many bags.
Disgusting.
So, yep, you're using a light side point. Yeah. Reroll it. Oh, I so wanted to keep that.
That's better.
That is better.
Okay.
I get a lower price, but I get advantages and a triumph.
So, if you want, you can use some strain to turn to help those dark side points.
No, I won't use the dark side. It's fine. We have lots of money. But
okay.
So I think it'll bring the price down, but he might offer me something else with the triumph and the advantages.
So he doesn't bring the price down, but he goes, you know what? Respect. You know, because as you're arguing it out, he goes, you put a lot of effort into that. I respect that. And you can tell he's still trying to keep you on board, even though he's blowing you off and getting the full price. He goes, go on. I'll tell you what I'll do for you. I'll, let's see. What can I do? He says, checking. Yes. I've got a thing that was,
Simon, you're frozen, by the way. Your camera.
Yeah, at the moment, until we go.
And there goes the voice.
And Simon's gone completely. Oh, there's... Hey!
We get everything!
Thou pulls the DM! Thou pulls the DM!
I'm in charge now! It's free! Everything's free! He just gives it to you! And then... And you have four arms now! And two of those arms are just blasters!
Oh, Paul is really the DM now! Because... Because we all got shuffled!
Discord. How we get all shuffled.
Everyone's gonna leave and come back in.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yes.
Weirdly, I can't see you at all now because Discord is gone on here.
Right.
Yeah, I have no Discord screen. I have nothing. I can't see anybody, and yet somehow I'm still connected. So it looks like the GUI is completely gone.
And let's go on a... We're almost a half past, so I'm going to say that we'll take a break now.
Okay, yes. Yeah, let's do our break now and come back at just past half past. We'll come back at, at 9:31, and we will continue this. But I'm not going to do too much in the way of shopping now. I wanted to do JT's upgrade, because that's pretty cool, because he's basically turning into RoboCop.
We can do shopping later. We have,
and then we can do other shopping later. That's fine. But I do want to do the Mandalorian armor thing because that's cool shit. So yeah, we'll take a quick break now. I will sort my shit out. And what's that?
Can I talk to you during the break? There were some things I was looking up.
Yeah, sure. So we'll take that break now, and we will see you guys in 10 minutes, and I'm just going to go slap Discord around until it behaves.
Bye.
See you soon. And welcome back, everybody. I just realised that's moved on to the wrong page, so I'm going to do that.
see you several times.
There we go. JT gets a holster on his back and a Robocop holster in his leg. His leg, he's now got a blaster shotgun. On his back, he's got a carbine. And being able to put all of these things in place and the extra structure you get from what is now a heavily armored, almost unrecognizable LEVO droid. You have been adapted so far beyond the original spec of an LEVO that you're just this hench battle droid now.
Half as wide again as I was originally.
Yeah, you are. You're just this broad-shouldered. You've now got effectively the same structure as a Deveronian. You're a big ass bugger.
What did I get for my triumph, by the way, Simon? I don't think you went through.
I was about to say that, wasn't I, before I cut out. Yeah. Osna says,
one of my previous contacts got me to do a commission, but he didn't end up paying. So I tell you what, you pay the full price, I'll throw this in.
And he puts what seems to be a thermal detonator on the desk.
Sure, well, that seems very reasonable. Thank you very much.
And he goes, this is after he's obviously reattached JT's legs, and he goes up to JT's midriff, touches a panel opens up, and he slots the grenade in. You have got, as a bonus, for the Triumph, a thermal detonator and a single grenade pocket inside your chassis. You can store one grenade and it will be hidden alongside the other.
Store the thermal detonator and then we cry.
The downside is that you have a thermal detonator inside you, but there we are.
As long as I don't get shot too much.
Yes, and Commander I'm sorry for butchering your name. Cephalo. His legs are back now, so that's all good.
So you walk out literally as Osna agreed, a new droid, to the point where a few people look at you and is like, who the hell is he? And it's only when you turn around and you've got the original head unit that they go, hey, yeah, nice, like it, because you don't disagree with someone's new style when you look like you currently look.
I think I've also gone for a colour change. Ooh. I think I'm a little black and gold like X4 is. Less chromey.
Less chromey, yeah.
The black and yellow, mostly black, yellow highlight.
Okay, so mostly black, and you've got, you kind of got like gold piping, yeah, because less is more, yeah. Now, that does turn a few heads, because mostly black droids are Imperial droids, mm-hmm. and it's only when they see that, you know, that you've kind of got this kind of, you know, this gold piping, which isn't on Imperial droids, it's black and red for them. They go, and then they kind of try to calm their heart down, because it looks like an Imperial battle droid has just walked onto the ship.
Guess who spent skill on coercion?
Oh,
okay. Yep, okay, that definitely tracks. So the next bit we're going to do quickly is Felicia.
Yeah.
You walk up to Kato's exchange, and the Nemoidian gives you a really genuine smile and says,
"Ah, I wondered when you would be coming. You have a package. Payment pending, of course."
Of course. And she will basically just text X4 to send over the footage.
He's waiting for what appears to be like he's like on a messenger service, and goes,
"You can use the side room."
And you walk into the side room, and Farrakes, or at least the helmet of Farrakes, the Mandalorian, says, "You didn't supply what we asked you to, but we can see from the footage that, someone took out the target before you did, but looking at the damage that you did in your first strike alone, and you can tell there's respect in the voice, its death was inevitable. We believe that, well, we're not unreasonable, Mandalorians, even though we can be harsh sometimes in the specifics of how we are dealt with. But in this case, we believe that you have honored the spirit of what we've asked for. As such, we've now unlocked the first lock on the crate. All you have to do is pay for it, and you're free to go.
Of course.
And Farrakes disappears from the screen. You come back out and Kato goes, "All went well, I assume."
Indeed.
Excellent.
You got a pain rubbery for the money.
For the package and the contents itself, that is 6,000 credits. And for the delivery costs and secure holding, that is another 2,000 credits. Ooh. That will be a total of 8,000 credits. A pleasure doing business with you.
Yes.
Are you with anyone, or is Chevron with you to help you with any type of negotiation? Because I would take
Would Chevron go with Victoria is the real question.
It depends. If you're heading anywhere near the local gunsmith, then I might be on alongside, but that's where Chevron's heading. He's got a new toy in his mind.
Yeah, I was heading to the trader, so...
Mm-hmm.
I'll give it a whirl.
Chevron, glad to see you here too.
Always a pleasure to bring you my repeat custom.
Spooning it on, go on.
As you can see, we've been on the receiving end of some significant upgrades in our capabilities, let's say, and I'm expecting that we'll be making more purchases soon, so surely you can ease us on our way.
That is the thing about being in charge of the exchange. Purchases do not do much in the way of business for me, other than the handling costs, which of course that's what we're talking about now. And he's kind of looking to see where the money would be. But are you referring to the fact that you are going to be ordering more things and that they will be coming through my humble exchange?
Well, I alone have several special items that I wish to order in the not too distant thing. And I will start sort of showing him the large numbers on the things that I have on the data pad in front of me, basically. It's like, yes.
I was worried when you went off to your now private, and it has to be said, unknown lodgings, that you would no longer be using my services.
Ah, but my tailor still works here.
Indeed. Very well. Let's see what we can do for you. Do me a... it's going to be a diff 3.
Oh, okay. Against negotiation, is this?
Your negotiation price, so it's negotiation.
Yeah, I'm less good at that, but hey! Oh no, it's not the worst.
It's
might happen.
No.
Oh no.
But with two advantages.
He goes, two advantages. You haven't lost any favour with him. He goes, it was a nice try. I respect your business acumen. That will be 8,000 credits.
Of course. And she will pay, Chevron did his thing, but, I'm the one paying. Here you go. It's fine.
This is 0.03% of our cash, by the way. It's
nothing. Yeah.
I don't know. 8,000 sold so much. And they're like, no, we have, a million.
I can see you're changing the credits as we go along, Ed. Can I leave you to do that?
I am the party scribe.
Yeah.
Okay, fantastic. Great, thank you very much. You pay the credits, and he goes, thank you for your business. And pulls around the crate, swipes his hand across it, and it pops open. And inside is a beautiful set of Mandalorian armor, as promised. You can see that it's got all of the... it's got all of the ports, all of the modular ports by which you'll be able to put on all your new toys. And the only
How
thing that's missing, of course...
is Chevron, who's standing right next to me, seeing Mandalorian armor?
So Chevron...
I didn't know that's what I was getting.
Is it shiny? Has it got the paint on it yet, or is it beautiful, sleek metal at this point?
It is beautifully shiny. They did say that they would tailor the armor to her as a warrior. Yeah? Mm-hmm. It is... fitting, first of all, it will fit your size and shape exactly. It has the same color scheme as your particular armor. Yes, it's made for your Valkyrie endowment.
It's proper boob plate. Fancy boob plate.
No, it's not boob plate. It's accommodating for her endowment. It's not boob plate, because boob plate is not real armor. See the film Elizabeth the Golden Age for details. I'm not going to get into my armor rant now.
Space wizards, I think, if you want to play.
It's space appropriate levels of sexy armor. I will go with that because I know that Felicia is going to be updating her portrait of Victoria anyway.
I need to add some form of headgear now because you included that.
Yeah, so the one thing that's missing is the helmet. And in place of the helmet, what you have is a single monocle kind of band that goes around. So,
a visor?
Okay, a visor.
Like,
yeah, that's
basically
fine.
Basically, you snap it on the ears and then it creates a visor like that.
Yeah, it's like a holovisor.
Oh, yes, holovisor. Yeah, holovisor. Yeah. It was going to be a holo eyepiece, but holovisor is fine. You change the setting so it does both eyes. It does have a slightly heavy section on the back, which does clip onto your formidable ponytail. And you notice that the reason why that's so heavy is that the headpiece itself does actually have a shielding mechanism. So even though you're not wearing a helmet, it still acts as if you are wearing one.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, I've done the reskin thing. Was it transmog? I've transmogged your space armor for you. You can see that there's tons of potential for attaching new toys on it. But at the moment, you've just got the base armor. I know it's something that you wanted. So what I'll say is, if you want, it can have the superior quality. I'll take up the appropriate slots. But if you want, it can be superior to start off with because it will already have superior armor plate. Yeah?
Yeah, that was one of the things I wanted. I was looking it up while we were on break now, and I have a few things I want.
In that case, Ed, can you knock off another 5,000 credits on that?
Now, that looks stellar.
Yeah. It is beautiful, isn't it?
Yeah. It's really stylish, considering that most of the Mandalorians look the same. You kind of expected when Victoria was going to get Mandalorian armor, but not being a Mandalorian herself, that she was going to get like a secondhand set or whatever they had lying about. They seem to have made it a point of pride to send her armor suitable for a warrior of her caliber because, and I'm not going to say it often, this is the way. So, you've currently got the superior modification. That takes up one of your six hard points. So you've got 5 hard points left.
Yeah.
Are you going to be filling any of those hard points now, or are you going to wait? Okay. What would you like to have added? I've got the rarities and things here, so what would you like to have added to the system?
I want a strength enhancement system.
So it turns it into power armor. Sure. Yeah. I'll add that to the thing to roll for in a minute. I'm not saying you're going to get it. I'm going to say we'll roll for it. Mm-hmm. So strength enhancing system. Oh, yeah, that's just a bunch of servos, rarity 4, no problem. So, and that with the servos and things that you'll need for that, it's considered to be just a kind of Gears of War mod, mechanical. So that's actually a rarity minus one. What else would you like?
Cortosis Weave, as we were talking about, to ignore piercing and stuff like that.
Okay, that's super high rarity for anything. That's going to need to be rolled for to see whether or not you can get it. And
yeah,
if you fail the...
I was expecting at least one thing to roll for, so that's fine.
And you
so if you fail the roll on that...
Yeah, I was going to say, with that one, you probably want to enlist the help of either Nima or Chevron. Probably Chevron, because he has all things where he can get things.
Yeah, since he's with me, I'll just tell him the stuff I want for it. And like, okay, you're better at these things. We need to get these things for this one.
I mean, I'm good at getting illegal stuff, specifically.
Well, we'll get to that. We'll get to that. You've also got your background of boy toy enthusiast that you can use on this. So,
really, and you said six hard points, right? One
so,
is the superior armor customization.
Yeah, so it's one for the superior armor customization. The enhanced strength system is an extra two. Then
Cortosis
is another two. You get one more.
It.
Yeah.
Yes, and I was thinking the enhanced optics suite.
To allow your visor to do things. Yep, absolutely. So that'll be your final hard point. So enhanced optics suite is easy. That's rarity three. And optics and sensors and things like that, things you'll find on Nala's Warren. So I'm actually going to bring that down by one because you've got favor. It's mostly the cortosis weave that you're going to have trouble with.
Nina's going to go and buy I don't know if it's their anniversary, but it'll be some celebration they're doing. She's going to go and buy a present, and she's going to buy the jetpack.
Aww. So,
with the money we all share.
Mm-hmm. So I'm going to get you to...
joint account and all of those things.
Yeah. Right, so for
we're showing it to Nima because, need to look hot.
Mm. So, Chevron, she starts talking about all these wonderful fashion items to pimp her ride even more. And I'm assuming that you're buying into this 100%.
Shopping spree, yes, please.
Yeah. Righto. So, ordinarily, it would be a negotiation check to get the enhanced optics suite and the strength enhancing system.
Remember, I have trader place. Yeah.
You do, yeah. So that's already been applied to the rarity, but also you will get a blue as you're doing this. Now, this is something for Chevron. Normally, this would be negotiation. If you want, you can put for each of these rolls, one roll for the cortosis weave and one roll for the strength enhancing system and the enhanced optic system. If you give yourself 1 point of obligation per roll, you can use any social stat you want.
Interesting. And dare I ask, to whom I would be being obligated to?
This would just increase your obsession. So you're trying to not be as obsessed with boy toys because it's bankrupting you. Although saying that, you've got enough funds at the moment to fund your habit. That's both a good and a bad thing.
I'm in.
Oh no.
Okay. Your obligation has just gone up by two. So first of all, I would like you to do a roll at diff 3 using the skill of your choice. And this will be to see if you can get, first of all, get, and then second of all, reduce the price of the enhanced optics suite and the strength enhancing system.
Okay, so I'm going to go with streetwise. Seems appropriate, and it's not bad as well.
Mm-hmm.
Nice.
I just looked at something.
Ooh!
We were talking about the jetpack earlier, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was planetary. I have skill in that.
Yeah.
I was thinking the other one.
Yeah, tragically can't fly around in space with a jetpack.
So you go out to your favorite people, Chevron. The people to whom the first one is free, and you start talking to them about the various things that you want, and you've got this kind of glassy-eyed look as your obligation goes up by a point, and your obsession gets fueled as you're there. Just, you know, this is fantastic. You've bought tons of stuff for yourself, and now you can kind of do it vicariously through somebody else. You never even thought that this could be a way of getting your fix. And
yes, because specifically, it's not an obsession; it's an addiction. His obligation addiction. Addiction.
Yeah, it's addiction, just like a drug. And so you're there, like, I could buy expensive, crazy things for other people, and so you now have a new source of addiction, and that is that you can now get addicted to buying things for anyone. So your obligation goes up by one, and what would have been what would it be? It would have been 7,250. You get it for 3,625, exactly half price, as the traders see you salivating and fuel the fire. Ed, can you take off 3,625? And I was about to say glory, Victoria. You now have your visor gets updated with all the best software, all the best overlays, ad free, and you get
the. Do I
get
the mod?
Yes.
You don't get the mod yet, but you actually get a bonus on the mod roll. Yeah, because it has to be modded by someone specifically, yeah. And then the strength enhancement system as well. That is just sleek. It's not just that you've got these servos adding to your already formidable strength, but you can't see the servos. The servos are silent, yeah? Mm-hmm. They are woven so neatly into your armor, it doesn't look like you have power armor. So, yeah, this stuff looks the business, to the point where you will get a reputation boost when you do cool things wearing this armor. So that's the first one.
I like.
So the second role for you, Chevron, is for the Cortosis Weave. Now, Cortosis Weave is high tech and it's high rarity at the base level. This is formidable. That's diff 5. But you can use the stat of your choice.
It's going to be streetwise again, because it is basically one of my best stats. So,
and you bottomed out on your points, so this is it. This is the role.
Aquarius, ad-free, lol. So, yes, there would be TV commercials appearing on the optic if it wasn't ad-free.
Yeah, unless you get the platinum package, you know, you get Viagra adverts, cat videos, things like that. It's not good. Oh, and he beats it. He beats the formidable.
God.
I will fix you up, boy.
Yes.
With
I will
be
the sweetest ass armor.
So they go, Cortosis. Oh, that's going to cost you. And you kind of talk, you end up obsessing with them for about 2 hours. And at the end of it, they can see, you know, your eyes have glazed over. This is going to be plus minus, yeah? So the first thing is that you managed to get what is 10,000 credits worth of Cortosis Weave for only 7,500 credits. That's the good news. Yeah? You succeeded. Well done. So Ed, if you can just take off 7,500 for the Cortosis Weave. Here's the downside. I'm going to flip a dark side to boost all those threats. And your obsession went up not by one for this transaction, but by 3.
Oh,
shit. So you gained 4 points of obligation, which has increased the chances of it kicking off a lot more. Okay?
Oh,
I'll leave the obligation table the same for now, but that is where you are.
Okay. Going to spend a lot of money soon. Oh no, it's as if I had access to a large slush fund. Who can imagine this possibly going wrong?
we go wrong?
When Chevron was broke, this was not a problem, but now...
Yeah, that million is going to disappear quick.
We're going to have to, like, give Chevron, like, a allowance that he can spend.
Yeah, spending fund.
Was it a daily withdrawal amount that he's allowed? Yeah.
Like, you can spend, like, 1,000 credits a day. I think that's fair.
So, your armor.
We're on our way to the gun dealership, so.
Mm hmm.
I feel like now I'm talking to my guys to some extent. So this is the point where, like, after Chevron's wax lyrical about, he's now deep in the fuge, as it were, of this, like, you know, like, trading frenzy. And at this point, basically, the data pad comes out, and you just this image of the Nova Viper, the toppest range pistol that exists. Basically, these things are precarious, delicate, but beautiful objet d'art of armaments, basically. And basically, Chevron basically just is like pointing with like unbrazen lust in his eyes, and there's like a whole load of notes beneath it about all the tweaks I want made to it and everything else, basically.
Yeah, so you already sent ahead, as did everybody else. You said that you sent the wish list ahead, and I'm going to say retrospectively that this is why they were buttering you up, because they are ready for you now. And as you mentioned the Viper, they reach under the desk and pull out a, let's call it a mahogany box with brass fittings. They open it up, and inside is a scarlet velvet lined box. And the object of your lust is right there in front of you. You can see that it's got the extra reload pack. It's got all of the extra things. It's got the monogrammed polishing cloth. It's got all of the extra fittings and bits. And at this point, I'm going to get you to make me a cool check, because I'm about to flip a dark side.
Ooh.
So I'm actually triggering your obligation in a minor way, so this is going to be a minor reckoning.
Okay, so what dip would you like, sir?
I would like a cool check at diff 4. And if you succeed at this cool check, you will control yourself somewhat. And
not blow your load instantly.
And you won't go for the whole damn thing. Okay? Ooh.
So there you go. Ooh. Some successes, a few kind of smattering of disadvantages as well, but there we go.
Okay. The disadvantages I'm going to translate directly into strain at this point.
Just the hands are shaking slightly and reaching forward.
Your heart, you're not sure if you're having a heart attack, but you're not finished with your conversation, so you'll, you know, priority conversation first, heart attack next. So you're there just shaking, but you manage to hold your cool as you're there going, looks all right. But you're kind of doing it whilst you're, you know, you've got sweat dripping down your back as this is happening. So you've got the details there. So what is the price of the Viper?
So what I'm going for is a Viper with a superior Viper, no less, mm-hmm. because why not? With the custom grip that makes it essentially linkable with my other weapons. That's the link mod, and the sight on the top, basically. So all in, it is basically just shy of 12k. So let's just call it that.
Yep.
For the extra few hundred creds for the monogram on the side. Why not?
So is that balanced hilt or is it?
No, that is linked from the smuggler's book. Basically what it lets me do is have it and another weapon. It drops the dual wielding diff.
Sure. Another one you're on about. So let's see.
So that is okay. I think the superiority is rare 6. That's the only other thing that's got a notable rarity.
Yeah. That does get boosted. So they say, so you've got the money. Let's talk. And it's not a flat price, yeah? You're saying it's 12,000 on the books. It is 12,000 on the books. But they're trying to play it up now. They teased you with the discount they gave you before. They gave you a hell of a lot of discount on Victoria's stuff. But now the hook is in and they're pulling hard on the rod. They're trying to get it so that you end up paying more. I would point out that for a rarity of this type, I should be asking 3 times the price.
It is. Yeah, I'm gonna. This is obscene. This is formidable difficulty check. It's horrifying. Uh-huh.
Yeah.
And so Victoria managed to offset that because once you ended up putting the offset on the mods, she came down to roughly times one. It was about times 1.5, but I brought it down to times one. But that was because she had all that extra help and favor from you, and also you got a. A triumph.
Yeah.
In this case, they are playing for 3 times that. So they start saying, well, surely all of this together is 36,000. And so I want you to do me a check at diff 4, negotiation, diff 4, to see how it goes.
And Chris, I don't know how to pronounce your name. Yes, he's trying to buy it anyway. It's just how excited he seems to be when he gets it, so he doesn't essentially just fangirl over it, and then they can charge him 5 times as much.
If he failed the roll, he wouldn't be able to negotiate down the price because he would just be yeah, whatever, and hand over the cash.
Yeah.
Okay, so there's diff 3 negotiation, yeah, mm-hmm. And a diff 4 negotiation.
Hmm. Sorry, a diff 4 for you.
Oh, it's flatline.
You have got a light side point.
Partly was because it's in character. I'm going to roll with it, man. If they want to flee Chevron at this point, he's in. He's just like everything he wants is right there on the table.
Ed, remove 36,000 from your pool.
I have no idea how Victoria reacts to Chevron just handing over this large wadge of jelly onto the table where he just slams it down. Sure.
We spent almost 20k on her, 15 maybe, something like that. So she's like, yeah, fair enough.
We're going to bar you from using that pool of money for at least a week.
1.8%.
Yeah, it's still not that much. I should imagine that as you're doing these negotiations, Victoria's just looking at her arm, doing little flexes and things, and not helping out in the slightest. So when you hand over the money, she doesn't even know how much you handed over.
I don't really care. It's a sweet-ass gun. I have a sweet-ass sword. Match.
Righto. So let's finish up with Nima quickly, and then let's go and get to the mission.
I didn't have anything specific that I was... I was just buying the jetpack for Victoria, but I wasn't buying anything specific for me.
Presumably this is while I'm on the table being disassembled.
Yes.
Oh, God, yeah, you're in pieces right now. Yeah, this is all concurrent. And you're in pieces, and Nima is with you, making sure that that they don't do anything to you whilst you're being put back together. So, she's a busy girl. Jetpack, I think, is... Where is it? It's on the gear page.
4.5k.
Yeah.
Yep, and I'm looking at the rarity as well.
7.
Rarity 7. Surprise, there's not much need for a jetpack when you're in a in an asteroid base. First of all, there's not much space to fly around in because there's no sky in an asteroid base. And also, if you were to try to use it outside the asteroid, it would be suicidal. So it's dangerous enough in a ship. So I'm going to go with a straight diff 4 negotiate. No, it's a diff 5. Diff 5... check for you, Nima, to get it. You're literally going up to a bounty hunter saying, hey, you got a jetpack. Know where I can get one? He's like, no. And you're like, how about yours then? And you're buying it off the guy.
I was going to say, who was our trader friend? My phone is in the kitchen. I left it there. I can't look up the Google Doc. But who was our trader friend who...
Caldrilla.
Yeah. Who Victoria was really good friends. I wanted to check if she could possibly maybe have one.
Yeah. Go on. Yeah, add a blue.
Okay. You said this is a negotiation check, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Hello, I'm buying a thing for my wife, who you know and like.
Uh-huh.
Well, Caldrilla is telling this bounty hunter that she will source him another jetpack if he sells this one to her.
Yeah.
Nima is literally buying the jetpack off a guy's back.
Where can I have this, please? Thank you.
Please. Roll it.
Yeah. I was checking, I got all my bonus dice and everything.
Take strain. Use the dark side.
Yeah, I will give in to the dark side for one strain, and I will turn it that into success so I can buy it from him.
Sure, he agrees to sell it for 9,000.
Can I bring that? No. Is there a way?
That was the roll.
That was the roll.
Yeah. Yeah. At the rarest he was talking about at the moment, even with Victoria's favor, which brought it down a level because of reputation, it was supposed to be times three. It was times two because of Victoria, and you just scraped by.
Yeah. I'm looking at the roll there. Is it worth re-rolling? But it was a pretty good roll to begin with. I mean, I only got two.
Is exactly what just happened.
Yeah.
You've had enough discounts.
Yeah.
Go on,
sure,
take it.
I'll buy it for 9,000. Haven't bought anything. So. Everybody else is spending money.
So you hand over some credits and this guy literally unbolts this thing from his armor and hands it to you. You just literally bought the shirt off his back. Yeah? So he's like, yeah, if I'm going to make a profit on this if you're going to buy this shit off my back. He wouldn't sell it at regular price.
0.04%.
Okay, so you all get back to the skiff.
I wrapped it in wrapping paper and everything, and I like put a bow on it.
And I'm like, honey, look at me and start flexing.
So you go back to the skiff, Nima, and you're joined by JT 2.0, your wife that's now wearing like full-on Mandalorian battle armor plus mods, and you know, I'm assuming that you're showing off the bling chevron.
Yeah.
Well, actually, the thing will be in the standard like shoulder holster. But mm-hmm. on the slightest provocation, yeah, it's coming out and being like, oh.
No.
Yeah, that. And I mean, I think it kind of comes out of the wash. But Shepard will also blatantly avoid himself some new shirts and that sort of stuff while we're at, because he can't walk past through the shopping district without having done so.
Okay. Yeah. In that case, do me a cool check at diff 3.
Keep your cool on shirts.
It's cool.
And with the advantage, you get a blue dice on the next social check that you do because you hit the fashion on the nose, my friend. I'm going to give you a vote.
I would just sort of look around at the three of us and then look at Neva and go, did you get yourself anything? Because, I mean, you know, we're rocking it right now.
She's got a big parcel on her lap. In fact, it's not on her lap because it would probably crush her legs.
Yeah.
But yeah, she's got a
Superfly now. We've got JT who's got his, you know, he's done a style upgrade. Everyone's had a style upgrade, basically.
I mean, I there's not much that I could buy it. But I want a lightsaber. I can't buy a lightsaber.
Nope, you can't.
Look, Nima.
I don't care who your contacts are. You're not getting a lightsaber.
Nima. Let me take you to my tailor just one time. I promise he'll kick you out.
I mean, yeah, I'm happy to go to the tailor and new clothes. That's cool.
Right. At some point, we'll go to it. We'll take Nima for a makeover.
Yes. Hi, Minion. Hi, I hope you're right.
Minion. Oh, Minion. Hey, how's it going, mate?
Yeah.
I have money. You have jetpack. I want jetpack.
Yeah.
Nice one, John.
I'm gonna ride. Plus, jetpack.
Yes, and I'm gonna give the giant gift, like slide it on the table.
Oh yeah, of course. Sorry, you're doing this. Yeah.
Yes, just jetpack gift.
You open up a jetpack, and it's already got all of the mag locks on it and everything else. And you with JT's new hench support, JT picks up the jetpack, puts it on your armor, activates the mag locks, and it just neatly just attaches to your Mandalorian armor. We have now made a monster.
Yes.
It's a proper flying Valkyrie.
The Valkyrie now flies. I'm going to fast forward you all
now. The Valkyrie now flies and has a sweet ass sword.
A Midian! Thank you so much!
A new subscriber! We have a new conspirator! He's joined the chaos! Minion will be joining to put twists into the...
We can thank you!
Yes, thank you so much!
So now both Minion and... Subhype! Now Minion will be joining Jordan in conspiring in the correct part of the Discord. Are you in the Discord already, Minion? You need to get on the Discord. Because all subscribers to the stream... before each session, get given a question of something getting added into the session. And they get to choose an element of each session that we run, each session that I run, of the role-playing games. Let's wreck these guys, Minion.
Look below the stream in the description. There should be a button saying Discord.
In the doobly-doo.
You're in it now. Perfect. One of the guys will put you in as a member, Minion. So fantastic. Okay.
You got the Snazzy Founders Badge. The first 50 people to subscribe to us do get the Founders Badge. There is 2 tickets, so there's 48 left.
Woo-hoo! Oh, of course. Yeah, they do, don't they? Yeah.
Simon, I can't give them access to the special room, so you'll have to do that in Discord.
Oh, yeah, that's between me and the subscribers. Players do not get access. even if players subscribe, they don't get access.
Likes to be mean to us and conspire behind our
backs. It's got to be something that you get for your subscription. I'm a big believer in this. And
fair,
channel points as well. Look, for those who are watching.
We take glory the power of shipping, so.
Yeah. So,
good and bad.
I'm going to push you guys on. We're going to do a diagonal swipe in Star Wars style. And you are now leaving your asteroid base, having prepared for the mission ahead of you. You're going to GR5-47, the hunting planet on which there is the Shame Den, explained as before by JT as a place where they would malnourish beasts for rich boy hunters to hunt down. Because, frankly, they were shit at hunting, and Daddy didn't want them in any real danger. So, you guys get your engines fired up, and you fire out into the sprawl. You know the usual thing. You need to fly through all of these asteroids and get out in time. Otherwise, there's going to be a penalty if you... arrive there late. Things will happen before you need to. And so let's get everybody in their slots. Where's everybody sitting on the ship?
IFF.
Okay. Yeah, identify for a friend and foe, the spotter station.
I'll take one of the cannons.
Yep, gunner one.
I'm going to attempt to sit first in my seat. I don't fit anymore.
Oh,
I'm too large for my old seat.
It just bends a little bit.
It is no longer your chair.
It's still my chair, I just can't sit in it.
I feel so bad. That was your comfort blanket. That's by the way, for those who haven't seen this before, this is the chair from their original YT-1300 that after their YT-1300 got blown up, he went back and salvaged his chair because it was basically where he calls home, his little nest, his dog bed, and now he's so henched up he can't sit in it. The feels.
But taking the pilot
JT
otherwise.
Taking the pilot station. I'm actually going to say that you can't even fit in the pilot seat now because of how big you are. So you end up having to go to the same part that X4 is in, and two ports open up in the floor. you lock in your feet to the floor, so you are hard mounted into the floor, and you interface with the ship, and you and the ship are now one. You pilot now standing up and just looking off into the distance with a virtual grid around you. I wanted to reward you for the moment you just had. So now, yeah, you've got the full-on kind of VR experience of the ship.
I'm flying the ship in third person.
Yeah, yeah. So the...
By the way, I'm going to increase the volume of the alerts because they're very low volume at the moment. I did not hear the alert at all. So I think...
Okay, cool. Yeah. Cool. Yeah, sounds good. Mm-hmm. And then... Victoria, you're gonna two?
Yeah. Excuse me,
okay.
I'm gonna one.
Okay, oh, yeah, okay. So Chevron gets good-naturedly nudged into the second position. Not that there's one or two on them, but, you know, she's got her chair as well. And X4 locks down in the plotter station. So, first of all, let's see, I've got a diff 3 on the sprawl at the moment. So I'm gonna get X2 to try for plotting.
Who's X2?
X2. X4. X4 fails to find an efficient plot going through, and it's actually going to add time on your trip. So you may need to punch it, but that's what you've been doing every session anyway.
We're not in a hurry to get there, but I guess.
In all fairness, there's less time penalties
JT
than your previous
going
missions.
Fast, so I guess
we forgot to upgrade the ship, didn't we? There's a bigger engine on it.
I have sent plans to everyone.
Oh dear.
I am fine with JT just saying, I'm going to make the ship better, and I'm like, what?
This is stuff that is going to take a while to get. So.
Is what Chevron will ask in that situation, I think.
Yeah. Well, there's going to be a recommendation of one of the things that you can put on the ship, and that's going to be X4 saying, yeah, I think we should put this on here. But anyway, you're not doing that now. So, Spotter, I want you to do a perception check at Diff 3, please.
Oh, yes, me. I was keeping track of the... Okay, Spotter did... actually it's 3 yellow, 2 of those, and then the 3, is that?
Mm-hmm.
And I don't use the 4 blue dice, so I'm just going to double check that I'm having the right numbers, coming through, yep, cool. Boom! 3 successes, 1 threat.
Sure, no problem. So you have lowered the piloting difficulty for JT by 1, and there's a load of black dice that I was going to apply because the sprawl has kind of weather conditions, basically how bad is the asteroid field around you, and it normally can remove black dice extra successes, so we'll do that. And next up is JT himself as a pilot. What's your speed going to be?
I'm going to flick my 3 do things switches, which translates to 3 speed.
Okay. So give me a diff 2 piloting check, please.
Ooh, I failed it.
You failed! Debris strike! So, the debris starts flying towards the ship, and
You can redo it.
It's the gunners. Give the gunners something to do.
Yeah.
Gunners, you've got a few bits of debris coming towards you. So let's see, what did you get? 2 advantages. Okay, so there's only one bit of debris coming towards you at the moment, but it is a large one. And I would like you to roll attacks with the ship. So with the turret that you're in, the diff is 2.
Yeah. And you don't add anything? 2 successes.
Pew pew. Okay. That's the first one. I'm just checking up your ship guns at the moment.
He really does need to be in the chair, doesn't he?
It's the new body. I'm just not used to it yet.
Yeah, he's getting used to it. It's like
so a success apiece. You do two blasts of 7 damage to this thing, and at ship level, that's enough to take off even a large asteroid coming towards you. The thing explodes dramatically, and as the detritus flies in every direction, the Lakota sails through, and you've managed to save the Lakota from being scratched up and start off with some hull damage. So, with the...
Yes, apparently we kill the rock. You're very correct, Julian. It's a dead rock.
But if they don't kill the rock, they start the mission with an already banged up ship, and that could lead to bad, bad things. Especially considering they're going out to the very most remote of space.
Yeah, we're going to the edge of the galaxy.
You're going to the absolute edge of the galaxy, yeah. X4 starts plotting.
We are at the edge of the galaxy, but we go edge of the galaxy.
Well, you're at the edge of the Empire space at the moment. This is going towards the edge of the galaxy itself. It's a wild space, what's called wild space. And the dangerous thing about wild space is that there's a lot of things out there that people don't even know about anecdotally. The galaxy's always moving, which is why you always have to keep replotting your routes, even things like the Hydean Way keeps changing as the galaxy moves. X4 is going to have to do quite a literal... daunting check to get to this place. So he plots a route, and with two successes.
Yeah, the music is suitably tense at the moment.
Good. And with two successes, the following happens. You are piloting along, JT, and suddenly there's this space turbulence. Turbulence doesn't happen much in space. And you suddenly contact X4 to find out if everything's okay. X4 turns to you and says, "Yes, I knew about this. There were rumors of a ghost nebula. I started plotting a route around it. We're going to be running up against the edges of it, but we shouldn't go into the thing itself." And it keeps going and going and going, and you have managed to narrowly escape, two successes, not so narrowly escape, having to do a bunch of piloting checks to stop you flying into pockets of colourless explosive gas. It's just kind of hitting the side of your ship, small amounts of it, and it's like popping candy at the moment. It's just enough to little explosions that just rattle the shields a bit, but don't do any damage to the ship itself. Kind of disappointed.
Trying to get us to spend that money.
Oh yeah, repairing the ship will cost you. That's the thing, that all of this stuff will chew away at the money. So that million doesn't stick around for long. Consistent millions are good.
Yeah. How much damage did we take?
Nine. Zero.
Zero, oh.
Yeah. X4 would have got a point of strain, but then after that, over the few days after that, he calms the hell down again. And Chevron, all of your strain has gone as well. So it's an uneventful trip. And lots of bad things would have happened, because nebula can be light years wide, and it would have added a few days to your journey where you didn't sleep. And I would have got you all to make resilience checks, but because there's no way you could have slept. Oh yeah, there's no way you could have slept through consistent explosions on the hull of your ship. Okay. Next time, Gadget, next time. So, you get to, and only JT will know this, you get to GR5-47, a lush, verdant jungle planet. And without even having to find the landing zone, you know from the topography where to land. The Lakota touches down in a slightly overgrown, but otherwise cleared out section of the forest. And standing there looking slightly dilapidated, with moss growing on the roof and a few breakages of windows and other such things, is what you know as the Lodge, JT. Clarity touches down and says, "We are all secure. Would you like X4 to stay with me and guard the ship?"
Yes.
Yes, I don't think he will be much use in the jungle. get tangled. What do you guys think?
I think it's better to have someone on board in case we need a quick escape. He could pilot the ship to us.
What are your opinion on this X4?
X4 goes, I'd rather not go where the trees are. And it kind of shuffles around. You know how an R2 unit or any R unit kind of shuffles around on its two legs?
Yeah.
It kind of it does a little shuffle and says, not designed for woodland.
Yeah. It's, you could stay here. And I give him a pat.
Okay.
Safe pair of hands to look after home base.
With his hedge arms.
Yes, our R unit has a little backpack on that unfolds into a pair of hench arms because that was something that the players wanted. Doesn't feel like a real R.
You indulge your soul, sir. You indulge your soul.
The ramp lowers and you guys walk out onto a lush, verdant lawn. Kind of like a chamomile lawn.
The droid equivalent of a deep breath in before I pick up my huge gun, a little arm flicks out of my waist and I just attach it on.
Nice.
Are you expecting to use that, JT?
Yes.
So this is JT's light repeating blaster. So for the viewers, a gun mounting has just come out of his hip and he's attached what is effectively a Star Wars minigun to his hip. Battle mode engaged.
Yep. I got my disruptor pistol ready to go.
The lodge in front of you is a luxury lodge, basically a large wood cabin. You can see that there is currently a neglected and algae-filled swimming pool. There seems to be some sort of outdoor barbecue and open bar section. And there's little kind of pod huts that are connected by walkways to the main building itself, which seem to be small luxury suites. And what would you like to do?
It doesn't look like anyone's been here for a while.
Yeah, it's been...
Well, this used to be your job, didn't it, JT? Anyone been around recently?
I was going to suggest we sweep for wildlife first. Then it was the shame pit you were looking for, wasn't it?
Yes, a shame, Dan.
Has shame.
It's a bowl. It's kind of stupid, but it's
we're
an
going
artifact.
We're going to sweep the manor for wildlife, and then we're going to the shame den. Break.
Yes.
Perception.
Okay. I'm going to fast forward one part of this, and that is. Even though it's clear that some animals have been in here, some of the broken windows and things like that, and the fact that the kitchen has been trashed, suggests that some creatures have come in looking for food. Otherwise, a lot of the things that have been here are pretty trashed up. It's not looking good. I would like rolls, if you're so inclined. If you're going to be looking for things, I would like a perception check for looking for items, appraising items, anything that might be useful. If you're looking for things that might be hidden, that's a skullduggery check, as you're looking for places where a smuggler might hide things. And I will allow a vigilance check from JT only.
I'm gonna go for a perception check. What diff, Sam?
This is one of the lovely things about the Star Wars Genesis system. Depending on what types of items you're looking for, you can set the diff. The higher the diff, the better the thing you might find.
I will go for this three then. Woohoo!
Okay. You managed to find quite a few things. So first of all, you found a pair of which one's the better one? It's a pair of scanner goggles and a pair of electro binoculars. Electro binoculars,
yeah.
Whatever.
Are you writing this down, Ed, in the dock? Cool. Nice.
Cool. So electro binoculars allow you to see normally in low light and extremely bright conditions. Can magnify targets up to 10 kilometers away, and when using these characters can also remove up to a black due to long range or poor light. And then the scanner goggles enhance vision through a blend of light amplification and thermal imaging. They are common in illegal and combat situations. They do not require extra effort or hands for operation. These particular ones are thermal scanner goggles.
Ooh.
Okay. So that is what you found. Well done. The success got you the electro goggles, but the
triumph
got you the thermal goggles. So they allow pretty much full vision to a certain range, up to medium range, in pitch darkness.
So, I
don't have skill in anything, so I did a different.
Okay.
I will give the thermal goggles to JT, I think, because he's the one in long range most of the time.
I've already got scanner goggles integrated into my chassis.
Oh, yeah.
Yep. Well, he replaced his eyes a while back.
Yep. Well, I will keep them around in my bag then.
In your bag, okay. Specify.
Oh,
good.
Oh, not bag, around my neck, but somewhere.
I was about to say, keep them on top of your head.
Yeah.
Keep them in place. So Victoria, with your successes, you managed to find two stim packs that are still in date. Mm. And you also find a good bottle of spirit. So this is basically a hip flask. You smell it, and it hasn't gone off. It hasn't tainted at all. You know that this can be used to regain strain. If somebody is getting close to strain, they can take a pull on this, but it does require a resilience check.
Because... Hey, Shabram, this looks like something you would drink.
I will give it a sniff, and I'm assuming it smells pretty potent.
This is effectively like single malt whiskey, and looking at the hip flask that it's in, it's from the Filthy Rich, so it's very much your bag.
Maybe not for now, but possibly for later, and I'll just
this is a Dutch courage thing, so if you're about to max out on strain, you can take a pull of this stuff, and it can give you strain, but if you fail the resilience check, you'll end up bladdered.
All right, I'll put it in the hip pocket where it belongs.
Okay.
Yeah, if possible, I would like to go. I'd like to look specifically for one of these rich boy stashes that I know the rich boys lived here. I'd like to go find their little, if they snuck anything under the floorboards or whatever.
Sure.
Okay. Rough with the smooth.
Definitely rough with the smooth. So the threats actually change what you find. You've managed to find what is a data pad with a diary from a rich boy. And this is blackmail pay data. You can use this to blackmail a rich boy into paying you to destroy the data.
Oh, shit.
All right, I've got a contract for our new friend, possibly.
You're going to ask a Java.
Hey, go give him a little test, see if he's worth his salt.
Yeah. That's, yeah, sure.
Yeah, that's from Maximilian, okay. Exactly, Jordan. That's what I said. And yes, all the rich boys time.
So, JT, bring it.
I've left these guys to do the upstairs of the manor because I never went in there. I'm downstairs with where the droid store is and where the weapon store is. But I'm also that it's on kind of on stilts, so you can see it's like a ski lodge basically.
Yeah.
Like there's the ski in, ski out bit, which I never left basically.
Yeah.
And so what diff for vigilance?
So for vigilance, the diff here is again chosen by you. You know this is a place where hunters once were. So, yeah. Depending on what you roll and what successes, advantages, and threats you get, is what you find. So I've got like a table. So give me, and the diff is your choice.
Yes. While they're doing the rolling, I'm just gonna say to that we are definitely reading all your messages at the moment. We're just, I might not respond to them right away because I'm having people talk and do things.
Yeah.
And the thing about blackmail is it never really ends. That is a very true snipe. Ooh.
So,
I'm distracted because it's a lot of bad memories, this place. These places are all much of a muchness. They're all kind of prefabricated and plopped onto these planets.
So, you don't find any of the things on this table. But you have advantages, and I did think that up. You have found a repair patch.
Fair enough.
So this will do a static 3 points of wound repair. Everything else has been trashed and looted.
Message to everyone. We're clear. Shame then.
Yes, let's see if we can find it. I hope the Force will guide me.
So, you don't need to get guided to the Shame Den. JT knows where it is.
Oh, okay. It's a specific place. Okay, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
The Force sent JT to guide you.
Yeah. I'm going to suggest that since we have the speeder bike and the land speeder, I go ahead in the speeder bike. Stealth scout, and you follow in the land speed.
Are you right with that, JT?
I will be.
Okay.
Okay, you know we're on comms all the time if you need to check where we're on.
New me. I've got to try this sometimes.
Okay, so you are triggering a reckoning. That's fine. Which has the potential of lowering your obligation. Yeah, the aphasia is really bad today. Don't mind me. So you get onto your speeder bike, and I'm just bringing that up on the document for me so I remember. So you get on your Starhawk? Yeah, your Starhawk speeder bike. And shoot off into the distance. And you know that there are creatures that will try to jump on you as you're flying by. So are you going to go at speed 1, 2, or 3?
I'm just going to go at speed... No, I'm going to go at speed 3. I can't not.
Okay. So you're going at speed 3. Ordinarily, because this is... very much Return of the Jedi speeder bikes and logs and tree trunks flying past you at insane speeds. Normally I would give you 3 black for difficult terrain, but there's a certain amount that you get rid of, isn't there?
I get rid of 2 for difficult terrain.
Okay. So give me a diff 3 with 1 black as you're zipping through the forest.
Sorry, just a 1 for difficult terrain. I didn't actually take that in the end.
All right, so just
3,
so,
2 black.
2 black, yeah.
Yeah, there we go.
So, as you're zipping along, you miss almost everything. And I say very much almost anything. With 2 strain... You unfortunately, so I'm going to apply the strain first. That's going to be the threats. I'm not going to do it as threats. You end up crashing. So it clips the underside of your Starhawk bike and the bike goes spinning. I would like you to do me a... what do I want here? I think it's going to be... It's going to be, I think, an athletics check. Athletics or coordination, your choice, as you get thrown off the bike.
Yeah, I think that's going to be coordination. I think that's probably better for me.
Okay, 2 black, and the diff is again 3.
That's still a fail.
Do you want to re-roll it?
I do not, no.
Okay. You flip off this thing, and I just need to check. Ooh, crashes.
He's got
to really
learn how to fail.
Hmm. So.
JT, do you copy?
You're getting static through mostly at the moment.
That's not a good thing.
Well, I've given you, like, I've got tracker darts on me, so I've presumably given you, like, the location of one of my tracker darts, so you know where I am. And you've just seen that my speed has gone down very quickly.
Yeah, and then...
Either I've stopped...
Yeah.
Or I've stopped.
Yeah. JT, do you copy? JT, do you read me?
I apologize for this. I've just realized that I've just...
One of us is driving the other...
I'll be driving if no one objects. I don't mind.
Yeah. I'm assuming that you guys are going quite slow in your multi-speeder.
Yeah.
Because it's effectively just a Jeep.
Yeah.
Here we go. Crash.
I'm okay at driving, but at the same time, Chevron would love to be driven, so I'm easier.
It's about the style, darling.
I think you have more agility, so I think, Chevron.
Yeah, I can upgrade one since I have one in planetary, but I only have two agility.
Yeah, I've just got three, basically, just from stat.
Right, I'm going to house rule it because I pulled the bloody what's it out.
Yeah, no worries.
There we go. I'm going to say that it is like being hit by one of these, and you had a thing. So you're going to take 3 points of strain and 5 damage.
Lovely.
5 damage before soak, I assume.
Oh yeah. What? Oh, that's a good point. What's your soak now?
5.
Oh, all that armor, all that beautiful armor has just paid off, and the biggest thing that's been hurt is your pride. As you
I
hit the
wrap
fucking
myself
deck.
Round a tree, and then swiftly unwrap myself from around that tree.
Sure. Wow. Wow. Okay. So you take a hit that's like being hit by, like a bullet. Yeah. It's kind of a full body thing, but the equivalent of you rolling and hitting a load of stuff is on 5. And that was me rolling to see whether or not I got any extra successes, and I didn't. You got 3 points of strain because I got 3 advantages on my roll. You take 3 points of strain. And at this point, I want you to do a cool check. And I'm going to say
What did his advantage do that he got on the thing, by the way, Simon?
The advantage that he had is that I threw a black dice in with the roll that I made for him hitting the deck. Yeah, which got rid of one of the successes. So that's the reason why I only gave base damage. I want you to do a cool check, JT. Diff 4. You are rattled to hell. You have just trashed the speeder, and you're out in the woods on your own.
I'm going to show you my cool check.
Is it completely trashed, Simon, or is it?
Oh, it's a speeder. It cannot survive in.
Those things are the easiest things to wreck, aka like in any Star Wars movie.
It spirals off into a tree and explodes.
Yeah.
And explodes. It is canon. That is what happens when you trash up a speeder bike.
By the way, this is my cool check.
One dice. At this 4. Oh god.
Yep, nope. Didn't think that was gonna happen.
I guess I start to panic.
You
yes,
do.
Yes, so?
JT, do you read me? I've been trying to contact him this entire time. JT, do you read me?
Yeah.
Would you have been contacting him the whole time?
Yeah, I've been trying because really? I saw when, because as he said, we have the tracker that he gave to us, and we saw him stop. Very
I'm carrying
violently.
Two tracker darts.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
And when I stopped, I've been trying to contact him. So.
Okay.
Yeah. You missed that when you were focused on the book. We were talking about it.
Yeah. Okay, fair enough. So you contact him. At the moment, you're on two black for everything that you do currently, JT, because you're rattled.
Yep, yep. That's entirely fair.
JT, do you copy?
I think what you're getting through now is text rather than voice.
Yes.
Not a... Not broadcasting over comms with his voice, but the text is, I'm fine. Speed a bike, trash. Pick up, please.
I say, okay, we'll be right by you to pick you up.
Yeah, when JT gets stressed, he goes low tech.
Yeah. I guess we'll put a little spurt of speed on.
But we'll be careful not to trash this one.
Okay. What speed would you like? You, I'm assuming that you're going at speed one so far, but what speed would you like to go
speed
at?
Speed two? Let's not trash.
Yeah, let's just... I don't want the Troy to get broken again, so I would squeeze the gas a bit and try and be a bit quicker in there. So speed two.
Sure. So give me a piloting planetary diff 2 with 3 black. Diff 2 with 2 black.
Yeesh, okay.
Can we help, Simon?
Yes, you can. Mm-hmm. You can add a blue to that for NEMA spotting.
I think Victoria has a skill in piloting planetary.
Yes, I do.
So
if you want, you can take one person's agility and the other person's piloting planetary.
Yeah, so you can get a yellow and a blue.
I have one skill in piloting.
Yeah, because cool, I would help with spotting if that is allowed. Especially.
Well, that's on Simon. So are we getting a blue as well, or I'm just doing the upgrade?
So what's your agility, Chevron?
Three.
Three. And what's your agility, Victoria?
Two.
Two. Okay, so in that case, the best combination between you all is a yellow and two greens.
Yeah. Can I help at all with the spotting, Simon? Or
Nope, when it's help of this kind. Well, actually, yeah, go on, have a blue as well.
Yeah.
And then two...
Thank you.
All right, well, I'll roll the blue as well, just in case.
Yep.
Woo!
But we're okay.
Yeah, so with a single success, you're going as fast as you dare, but no faster. And, yeah, you're having to weave a little bit, and there's a few kind of clench moments, but you managed to get to JT, no problem at all. And,
so especially the wheels not going the same, well, not the wheels, but you still feel the vehicle not going the same direction it's pointing, you know.
Mm. Yeah, and bear in mind, this is land speeder, so it's hovering. So you get to JT, and JT's just standing there in the middle of the, clearing.
Stock still, my top of my torso is rotating and kind of keeping an eye out. Mm-hmm. I've gone back to kind of base programming.
Yeah.
So, I told you we should have sold that bike. Now, should hop on and we'll carry on.
JT, are you right?
Okay, hang on. I'm going to feed JT a line.
Are you right, JT?
I'm afraid we can't go on.
You see, we are surrounded.
Oh, shit.
Well.
And,
now it's getting interesting.
So you, to round up, because we are just about getting to 11 o'clock, as you pull your land speeder up to JT, just standing there, kind of doing a standard scanning backwards and forwards, he says, I'm afraid we can't go on. You see, we are surrounded. And as you look around you, there are eyes in the bushes. And at that, we will stop this session and we'll continue the Shame Den next Tuesday.
I was so looking forward to JT being able to get rid of his obligation.
You could have re-rolled some if you wanted to, and maybe get a better result.
No, it's a great story. He tries to like be brave and get it out, and it doesn't go well. A good story.
Yes.
It's one of the things I love about the obligation system, both in optionally in Genesis and especially in Edge of Empire. And that is that you can put something in there that you can either gain more of it or you can get less of it, and it can trigger as you go on. With Reckonings, which is something that somebody suggested, you can have where if you deliberately try to challenge your obligation, in this case, JT's kind of PTSD, it can go well and your obligation goes down, which means the chances of me rolling on the D100 are far fewer, or it can go hideously, hideously wrong, and you'll get tons extra. And unfortunately, it went in the latter direction. So
It wasn't that long. It was like a few minutes
It was a few minutes, but it's what happened. He ended up failing piloting, which is his raison d'être. He trashed the ship. Hit the dirt, which, okay, with his new hench form, it's not so much of a problem, and found himself surrounded by things.
Yeah.
Bye, Simon.
Oh.
Bye, Simon.
Oh, no.
Either way, thank you.
We'll see you all next week.
Yeah.
It's been great. We'll see you again on...
And for everybody else. And
Simon, you just disappeared and we started the outro without you. I'm sorry.
Yeah, so we're gonna see
you all on Thursday?
Yes, Thursday.
Yes.
For some dragon slaying for St. George's Day.
And some of our viewers will be joining then.
Yeah.
I suggest, Minion, as a subscriber, you should get first seat if you have the time. Go check it out in the Discord.
Yes. If you're still in chat, Minion, I'm not sure if you are.
Either way. We'll see you all then.
Yes,
bye-bye.
Paul is now the DM. Just
yes.
Yes. And we will... Bye.